Members, the item on the order paper, first item on the order paper is a motion on a public inquiry into the renewable heat incentive scheme. Business committee has agreed to allow up to 2 hours for this debate. Proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this assembly recognises the mounting public concern relating to the renewable heat incentive scheme and the serious allegations of incompetence, corruption and abuse. Further recognises the damage caused to the public confidence in these devolved democratic institutions. Calls for the establishment of a public inquiry under the Inquiries Act 2005 to be chaired by a judicial figure proposed by the Lord Chief Justice. Believes that the First Minister should stand aside pending publication of the final inquiry report. Further believes that the terms of reference should include the development and operation of the scheme, any matter in relation to policy, financial, operation and compliance, the role and conduct of relevant persons and organisations, assess if there were breaches of any relevant code, public standards or employment contract, the response to and treatment of persons who raised concerns, if any person with a potential conflict of interest acted to their own benefit or the benefit of others, assess all renewable heat incentive scheme applications and report on any actions to be taken in respect of suspected fraud, the suspension and recovery of payments and the future operation of the scheme. Make such recommendations as the inquiry believes necessary, including in relation to any issue of potential malfeasance in public office or suspected criminal activity identified. Believes that the inquiry should issue a final report within 6 months of its commencement, with the provision for interim reports at least on a two-monthly basis. Further calls for all inquiry reports to be published in full upon completion, without requiring the agreement of any executive minister, the executive, or the Secretary of State, with copies of any report lodged in the Assembly Library. Calls for any case of suspected fraud identified to be referred to the PSNI, and further calls on the Minister of Finance and the Minister for the Economy to bring forward a plan to arrest the liability to the public purse.
Thank you. I call Claire Hanna to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members, yesterday we gathered together to discuss some of the proposals for cost recovery in renewable heat incentive scheme, and today this motion is attempting to put in place finally a public inquiry to establish who has been responsible for this governance disaster, what lessons can be learned and implemented, and to do all this in public and free from political interference or cover-up or the perception of cover-up. If these institutions are falling over, at least in part, this issue, and people being told are to have their say, it's our duty to give them the information to have their say as much as possible. Not the spin, not the facts, not just the facts. Who decided to amend the scheme from Britain? Why warnings were ignored if they were made? What warnings were made? What opportunities were and weren't taken to fix the problem? Who benefited from it? I hear Sinn Féin in the media branding this a meaningless discussion today. That party abstained on the topic of a public inquiry earlier this month in Belfast City Hall, and it looks like they will as well. They can brand accountability as meaningless, but many will interpret it as another way of avoiding the question, what did you know, when did you know it, and what did you do about it? And presumably they're voting to water down an investigation into NAMA a few months ago was meaningless as well, and not just the character of their opposition to accountability that to them is just about soundbites and distraction. Accountability is, of course, a very important principle in public life. It's the norm in politics around the world, everywhere except here. It would seem that a minister will take responsibility for a disaster in his or her department. This motion, at a minimum, required the First Minister to stand aside for the duration of an inquiry, though I accept that's now a moot point, as we're all being stood aside next week for our sins. I'd be happy to.
And isn't it a shame that Arlene Foster is no longer First Minister? We have the same outcome in that regard, but what we don't have is a public inquiry, and what we do have is now unstable institutions. Surely she should have done the right thing and stepped aside.
I I couldn't agree more with the member, and I think a lot of this could have been avoided by showing that humility by living up to that principle of accountability in public life. I think the motion as listed is fairly comprehensive in an overview of what we're proposing, but I just want to speak to a few specific aspects and address some of the criticisms and concerns people have stated. Another red herring, I think, that has been raised, particularly from the party, usually to my right, but absent today, part of their 12 days of Christmas positions on this public inquiry in the last few weeks, that said they didn't want a public inquiry, and they brought up criticism by the SDLP, by other parties and by human rights groups of the 2005 Inquiries Act, and that criticism stands on the issue of using national security as a blocker to get to truth, which is a convenient mutual veto that the party beside me benefits from as well. But if Sinn Féin can explain what aspect of the renewable heat incentive issue they think is going to be used to invoke a national security clause in this inquiry, then their protestations would have some weight. Other deflection tactics were used. This could cost millions and years, as previous inquiries certainly have, but they don't have to take forever, and many don't. Some of the first conducted under similar legislation in the Republic were quick and effective and good value for money, and I'm thinking in particular of the first Haughey inquiry, and in particular the 1999 Dirt inquiry into allegations of tax evasion in the banking sector. That concluded after 26 days on budget, led to prosecutions, and was a triumph for transparency and public accountability. Yes, some of the corruption scandals have dragged out over the years, primarily due to the challenges of the fact that time had elapsed, the challenges of compelling private individuals and getting access to private information. But this is also a red herring. In this case, this is a relatively fresh scandal. Almost all of those involved, be they elected members or special advisers or civil servants, are still in post, or at very least still in the neighbourhood, and can be invited to come along. And all of the relevant papers will be or should be a matter of record within the department. So we shouldn't see the same level of legal battles to compel some of those papers. Our proposals also suggest that the judge to lead the inquiry be appointed by the Lord Chief Justice. We reject entirely the suggestion that it would be appointed by the Attorney General, who is himself a political appointee of this executive. So anybody, I think it's fair to say that wouldn't have the arm's length removed that an inquiry would need. The format for the inquiry, as is outlined, will facilitate cost recovery from those claims that are found to be fraudulent, and can provide the basis for prosecution if malfeasance in public office is demonstrated, or if other willful fraudulent exploitation of the scheme is found. The inquiry should take no more than 6 months, which we think is entirely plausible, with updates at 2 monthly intervals, and it shouldn't require approval from any ministers, hopefully ministers in this assembly or potentially direct rule ministers, but one way or the other, this proposal will not be able to be, the outcome of this inquiry will not be able to kick into the long grass, and the outcomes can't be suppressed, of course.
Appreciate the member giving way. I think what she's actually said in all the points she's highlighted so far is that the terms of reference under which an inquiry is set up could entirely deal with all the bogus objections which have been raised to it. And also, very specifically, an inquiry under the Inquiries Act would not be for ministers to withhold information, but the information would be released by the judge who chairs the inquiry.
I think the member is entirely correct, and I think that is what it's regrettable, that we're now on the 16th of January and these proposals, this has been in existence. We've been discussing these particular proposals for going on a month now, and the mechanisms we need are in legislation. It was always a fallacy that we would create new legislation, and the fact that this House is not going to be here after next week makes very clear that we wouldn't have been able to create new legislation. But you're absolutely right, we are ready to proceed on this. Yes.
Does the member not also agree that, considering we could be several weeks into a public inquiry in terms of establishing the truth, that every day that has gone by, £85,000 of the public's money has been squandered? And does she not think that that is an absolute shame?
I do. I agree. I think that the loss of the public money is a great shame, and the fact that people are being pushed into an election to have their say on accountability and corruption without actually being given all the facts. We've become used in this society not to getting answers, unfortunately, and whether that refers to legacy issues of the past or glossing over the alphabet soup of scandals of this executive around NAMA, around SIF and around Renewable Heat Incentive and many, many others. But we need to change that culture. We need to start getting to answers, and we need people to understand that this Assembly is more than a racket and a farce. We regret that an election has been forced before we've had the answers on this issue. But unless parties choose to stand in the way of this motion, then it should lead to an inquiry about who knew what and when and what they did about it. And those who don't fear being asked those questions should have no problem in supporting this motion, supporting this inquiry and restoring some accountability.
Thank you. I call Emma Little-Pengilly.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I rise to speak on the motion and outline my full support for an independent judge-led inquiry. Inquiries can take many forms, statutory, judicial, under the Inquiries Act. However, the form must include full independence, public confidence and sufficient robustness to get to the truth, and this must happen as soon as possible. There have been many allegations and much politicking on this issue across all parties. Firstly, I want to put clearly on the record that I welcome the acknowledgement of regret by Arlene Foster, from senior officials in their evidence to the committee, and just yesterday from the Economy Minister. Make no mistake, I clearly understand, and we all clearly understand, the significant concern of the public on this issue. As chairperson of the Finance Committee, my role is in high quality and prudent guardianship of public funds. This did not happen in this case. Mistakes were made. Good policy development and design is critical to ensuring government policies deliver on their intended outcomes. Likewise, we need effective scrutiny to ensure that if and when mistakes are made in design, that these are picked up and addressed. We all need to step back on this issue and look at this objectively. Yes, there was a failure in policy design, but also a failure of scrutiny. The safeguards that we put in place did not deliver. This scheme, the original scheme, got executive approval, committee scrutiny and agreement, assembly scrutiny and agreement, and all of that failed to pick up this flaw in the initial design stage. We need to know why. I'm sorry, I've only 5 minutes, unfortunately. If we are to move to a truly normalised political landscape here, and I believe that is very much what the people of Northern Ireland want, then this will require political maturity. The era of throwing tantrums and the toys out of the pram must be left in the past. Mistakes will happen. Our processes are made up of people, and people are fallible. But we need to work collectively. That is our responsibility, to prevent mistakes, but also to find solutions when they happen. We needed calm heads and clear thought. The Assembly became fixated on the stepping aside issue. And we, in my view, should have focused on two things. Firstly, how did this happen? And secondly, how can this be fixed? That is our duty, and that is a duty on all of us. There have been very many nasty allegations thrown around this chamber over the last number of weeks and months. Let me say this, and I say this very clearly. I am not corrupt, and I am not arrogant. And I honestly believe that my colleagues and the colleagues that serve in this chamber are not arrogant or corrupt either. I got involved in politics to serve the people, to do my utmost to use all and any ability that I have to do what is right, to be an advocate and to deliver for the people of South Belfast and for Northern Ireland. I am saddened that the hunt of one person and the issue of stepping aside has been used in a way which is now threatening the very institutions. I do not think that is justified, and in fact it will only serve to delay the very necessary inquiry even further. I remain, as I know my colleagues in the DUP are, fully committed to to building a better and shared future for all in Northern Ireland.
I call Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I speak as Chair of the Public Accounts Committee. It is not usual for the Chair to speak about an inquiry before the committee has concluded its evidence and reported on its findings and recommendations. In respect of this precedent, I will not comment in any great detail on the committee's deliberations beyond what has been discussed in evidence sessions and as a matter of public record. However, I did feel the need to speak today to highlight the substantial amount of work undertaken already by the Public Accounts Committee in conducting its inquiry to demand answers on what went so badly wrong in the RHI scheme. How did it happen and how should it be fixed? Although it may have only been a short time that I have been Chair of the Public Accounts Committee, I am proud to have held this office for the 8 months and of the committee's work in that time. I am grateful for the support of the members of the committee in bringing the RHI issue to the fore in what has been a very challenging times, but also for making my job as chairperson easier, and some times for the experience that I've had of being a father of two small children has also helped in the committee as well. I will also thank the committee clerk and their staff for their support, but I want to pay a special tribute to the Controller Auditor General and his team who initially brought this issue to the fore. As Chair of the Public Accounts Committee, I wish to commend the enormous amount of work the committee has carried out over the last 6 months in its inquiry into the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme. Over the course of 6 evidence sessions, some very serious issues in relation to the design, administration and governance of this scheme has arisen.
Would the member give way?
Certainly.
Would the member agree with me that it's very strange that the ministers responsible did not bring this issue forward to this Assembly, but it was left to the Auditor-General to uncover it?
The member has an extra minute.
I thank the member for the extra minute, but as I said earlier, I won't be commenting outside that at this stage. The committee was briefed by the Controller and Auditor-General on the 22nd of June on the scale of the problem, which had resulted in him qualifying his audited opinion for the 2015-16 financial accounts for the Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investment in respect of RHI. This was because a substantial part of this expenditure was not approved by DFP, and he was not satisfied that the systems being operated by DETI were adequate to prevent or detect the abuse of the scheme. Members were shocked by the magnitude of the cost of the scheme, which could potentially cost the public purse £1.18 billion over 20 years. Key issues that the CNAG reported included that the scheme had exceeded the maximum amount Her Majesty's Treasurer was prepared to fund, and that the excess funding would now have to be met from the Northern Ireland Block Grant, and that significant cost would continue until 2036. The committee heard from the department how it failed to obtain the required approval for DFP for the £11.9 million of expenditure during a 7-month period between 2015-16. In addition to this, the design of the scheme crucially did not introduce tiering of payments as operated in Great Britain, where a reduced rate was applied after the equipment had been operating for 15% of the hours in a year. The Controller and Auditor General's report made clear that had tiering been introduced, this would have helped prevent the potential abuse of the scheme and what has become known as the Ash for Cash scandal. And we would not be here today. The committee heard how there have been allegations of abuse by an anonymous whistleblowers, which, while still under investigation, appear to point to the lack of controls in the scheme, which could have prevented the alleged abuses. The committee also learned how the administration of the scheme was largely left to Ofgem, and that the rate of inspection was very low, actually at 0.86% of applications, less than 1% of all applications. Recent inspections by Ofgems of areas of high risk appear to confirm that there are indeed serious compliance issues. The committee shared its concerns about the design of the non-domestic RHI scheme and the manner in which the department had operated and monitored it, which had made it completely vulnerable to abuse. The high level of applications received around the time of the spike and concerns raised by the whistleblower compounded these concerns and still remain unanswered. It was therefore not surprising that the committee prioritised RHI to the degree that it has. All other priorities have been pushed to one side to get to the bottom of what went so badly wrong with the scheme. Members have worked tirelessly to get the answers from all the main players in this sorry saga, from the former DETI accounting officer, who has been before the committee 3 times, Ofgem, Cambridge Economic Policy Associates, who were the consultants on the scheme, and another former Deputy Accounting Officer for the Department of Finance. The key issues raised by the Controller Auditor General have been explored in great detail by PAC, including the role of Ofgem on the quality and lack of inspections, the poor design of the scheme and the many errors associated with this scheme, which are well documented in Hansard as part of the proceedings of the Public Accounts Committee's inquiry. The Committee has pursued this inquiry as a top priority and continues to put pressure on the Department to provide answers as a matter of urgencies in the interest of transparency, good governance and accountability. While in some quarters the media seems to be taking all the credit for bringing this issue to the fore, it has been the sheer diligence, dogged determination and commitment of the Public Accounts Committee which has spearheaded action to address the main failings of this scheme. During its inquiry, the Public Accounts Committee has put pressure on the Department to take action urgently and address the problem of cost controls. It has pushed for 100% inspections, demanded transparency regarding the list of applicants and seeks answers to the alleged abuses of the scheme. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. I call Dr. Stephen Farry.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise obviously to speak in favour of the motion, and just picking up from the last speaker, just to recognise the ongoing role of the Public Accounts Committee in terms of working on behalf of this House in terms of providing accountability in relation to this. Can I say that for some people this seems to be evolving into a blame game between the DUP and Sinn Féin over an election in terms of who walked out of the executive first and how much RHI was responsible for this or the default on various equality agendas. But the bottom line here is what this is going to be about is whether people can have good government in Northern Ireland. Around the world, people expect and indeed deserve to have good government. And what that means is that there are strong policy outcomes that people are working to deliver upon the needs of society, and there are proper accountability and transparency in government. Instead, we have a litany of failures in terms of the current executive, in terms of use of resources and accountability and transparency. Now, there are numerous examples of that, and obviously in terms of RHI, the costs are enormous. But at the same time, we have issues around things like cost of division, where there's an ongoing cost of many hundreds of millions of pounds every year in the public purse, and things like the Social Investment Fund, which is a corruption in terms of public policy making and the use of resources, if we are using the words corrupt. But RHI has struck a chord with people because they understand the waste of resources. It really relates to their daily lives and the struggles that they have and how people are seen to be taking advantage of what has been an overly generous scheme. And they can understand what at best can be described as clear incompetence in terms of government. And of course, there may be and there are suspicions that it is more than that. Now, obviously, there's two parallel discussions we have to have. One is around mitigation, and the other is around accountability. Both need to be addressed. And anyone who says, well, let's park the accountability, we're focusing on mitigation, or people say, let's do the accountability and not address the mitigation, aren't actually doing their job. The two are parallel tracks that go hand in hand. Now, in terms of accountability, there's three main questions we have to address. One is the design of the scheme. The second is the way whistleblowers were handled. The third is the speed, or the lack of speed, I should stress, with which remedial action was taken over the past 12-18 months, indeed, even going back further in terms of ensuring that an overly generous scheme is shut down. There are suspicions that basically the attitude from government was that basically, given this was being paid for by EMA money, or so people thought, therefore we didn't really have to bother with all of this. But that is taxpayers' money as well, just as much as the block grant is taxpayers' money. And in that regard, I have to say I am disappointed with the passive approach that's been taken by the UK Treasury and indeed the Secretary of State in terms of seeing this as purely a matter for the Northern Ireland Assembly. This is a matter for every single taxpayer in the United Kingdom. It is important to stress that the request for Arlene Foster to step aside was only one part of this, but it is not an unreasonable request. And in any other walk of life, someone who comes under a sustained range of allegations, and I stress the word allegations, would be expected to go off on what we often call gardening leave. Clearly, we are moving more towards a consensus on public inquiry. The DEP have now come to that late, and anyone who suggests the DEP have always been in favour of public inquiry has not been following what has been said. Indeed, we're getting into slightly Orwellian post-truth politics where people are making this up as they go along, but the record clearly shows where they have been in that particular regard. But even in the past few days, we have seen the DEP leader stressing that there will be a public inquiry announced imminently, and the clock is ticking and we still haven't heard anything in that regard. Though how a backbench member of the Assembly dictates to ministers, I'm not entirely sure how that particularly works. So a few other concerns I think we do need to recognise. One is the potential politicisation of the civil service, and I say that with a degree of reservation, but I am slightly concerned whenever we see civil servants' names being quoted as part of political debates and documents being selectively briefed to the media, including references to civil servants to back up political points. I think that's something that may come back to haunt us, and it's important across these islands that we preserve the impartiality of the civil service irrespective of who's in charge. Also, the nature of how government is operated, it's not something that I would recognise or my colleague David Ford would recognise in terms of how we did things, where we have special advisers playing games behind the scenes, and indeed special advisers being named. Everything a special advisor does is in the name of a minister, and it's important that is fully understood, members, and that we have proper collaboration as we practice in government between members, ministers, advisers and civil servants. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Mr Gordon Dunn.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I rise today to speak on this item of business that has been brought before the House, and as an MLA and also a member of the PAC. And I must say the Public Accounts Committee have had a rigorous programme of work, and we have gone through a number of months of concentrating on that work and engaged with a number of those involved in the scheme. And all members, and I would stress all members of the various parties, fully participated in discussion in that PAC. Before the Renewable Heating Incentive Scheme was introduced, there were many calls to try and move away from an over-reliance on imported fossil fuels. There is no doubt that mistakes and errors have been made within the RHI scheme, and that has been acknowledged by Arlene Foster, our former First Minister, time and time again. And in the House on the 19th of December 2016, she reiterated that, and by our Economy Minister, Simon Hamilton, on a number of occasions. Indeed, Arlene Foster has indicated that she is happy to attend the Public Accounts Committee, and she is fully supportive of any inquiry or investigation and happy to appear before it. Our focus has rightly been upon resolving the RHI issue and getting to the bottom of what really happened. Yesterday, the Economy Minister brought his mitigation plans to the Economy Committee and to this House, and I believe these plans will be a crucial first step in reducing the burden on our budget and improving the level of control of the RHI scheme. The lack of control measures and the flaws in its design has been acknowledged. And indeed, as a member of the Public Accounts Committee, at a recent meeting, we heard from the Permanent Secretary, who stated the intention was good, but the execution and design were seriously wrong. The consultants, indeed, and it's already been mentioned, who Detti engaged to design the scheme, admitted at the committee that regression, which would have controlled payments on demand, was missed. They freely admitted to the committee that the idea of regression was missed. No thanks. There were clear risks from the start that there were two bodies involved. And to me, that was a clear risk. There were two bodies involved managing this scheme. Detti responsible for the policy framework, and Ofgem were responsible for managing the application and installations, including compliance. The Ofgem, who were working on the ground, did not even have a representative based in Northern Ireland. The other major discrepancy was there was no pre-approvals for applications to the scheme. Audits on the ground were very poor, Only a small sample was carried out and they were not risk-based. There was poor communication and follow-up on the issues raised during those audits. There was a clear risk of ownership and responsibility of the scheme. Departmental officials admitted poor management of this scheme, with no proper management in place. Project management, which would have involved a process of authorisation, qualification and review, were all not adequately in place. No thanks. There was no evidence of management review by DETI in place. There was no clear establishment of a risk register ever been in place, which identified the major financial risk of overspend of this project. The business case, which was referred to by the Department of Finance on the 9th of March 2012, stated Ofgem will provide regular management reports which will enable the uptake to be carefully monitored and forecast expenditure to DETI. Again, no evidence of this ever taking place by the Department.
I ask the Member to conclude his remarks.
Mr Deputy Speaker, what is important, we get to the bottom of this problem and that corrective actions are put in place to stop recurrence and lessons learned from this project applied to all government departments. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Mr Gordon Lyons.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. Welcome the opportunity to take part in this debate today and to speak to the motion. And all members are aware of the serious public interest, concern and indeed anger that has come to the fore in regards to this issue. People are deeply, deeply troubled by what is going on and they want to see action taken in relation to it. There are two things I believe that the public want to see, and there are two things that this motion does address. The first one, and I think the most pressing one, is that people want to make sure that the costs that we could incur in Northern Ireland are brought under control. That is first and foremost, I believe, the most important thing that the public want. They have been angered by this, not by the fact that there is a scheme in place, but angered most of all by the fraud or the allegations of fraud and abuse and waste. And that is very troubling indeed for many people, and it is important that those costs are brought under control. And the motion does call on the Minister of Finance and the Minister of the Economy to bring forward a plan to arrest the liability to the public purse. And we obviously had that discussion and that debate yesterday. Yes, I'll give way to the member.
The member has indicated his concern for potential fraud involved in this scheme, and that has been his focus. But would he also share my concern that the Auditor General has highlighted that legally individuals who burnt the wood 24 hours a day, or the pellets 24 hours a day, could make a return of, I think it was 82 or 83% per annum, which is a ridiculous amount of profit. Would he share my concern that the scheme was set up with the potential to make that sort of profit?
The member has an additional minute.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I think that exactly was the point that I was making, that there is public concern out there over the fact that people were getting so much money, not because they were generating heat for legitimate purposes, but they were burning in order to get to make money out of. That's the whole point. That's where the public anger is coming from. So it is important that we see I'm not giving away just at this moment. That is why it's important that we have these cost controls in place. So we get that done first, but then the other issue that we obviously need to address is to find out how this happened in the first place, how we got to this point, how this could have been prevented, what measures could have been put in place sooner, who knew what, when, and why. And we have no problem bringing all of that to the fore, making sure that that information is in the public domain so that people can see for themselves the process, so that we can learn lessons from this as well. I think that that is very, very important, and I believe that if those two steps are taken, it will go a long way in terms of restoring some of the public confidence that has been damaged. Very briefly, yes,
to the member. The member appreciates the fact that there's a bit of an irony in the fact that the only party now saying they don't want an inquiry under the Inquiries Act is a party that supposedly left, is a party that supposedly left the government over this issue.
Absolutely, and the member must have very good eyesight, because maybe he was reading my notes, because that's exactly the point that I was going to come to. If these are the issues that the people want to see addressed, cost controls and an investigation or inquiry into these matters, we have been very forthright in saying we want to see these things happen. Indeed, at the executive meeting on the 14th of December, it was agreed with Sinn Féin that there would be facts, that all the facts would be brought to the fore, and that cost-cutting controls would also be agreed. But they have now walked away from all of that. And I think that everybody in this chamber now knows that Sinn Féin have not taken the actions that they have taken over the last number of weeks because of some concern over a public inquiry or because of some concern over cost control measures in relation to RHI. But Sinn Féin have taken the action that they have taken because they want to bring down Stormont, because they are getting so much grief and so much of a hard time from their heartlands, or perhaps, as you call them, their former heartlands. That is the grief that is coming to them, and that is why they have taken the action. Because let's be honest, and everybody in here knows this, and everybody in here watching, or everybody watching must know this, that if they were really concerned about these issues, they would have been here yesterday and they would have been here today looking at these matters. And that's the truth of the matter. Of course, I'll give way to Mr. Dixon.
Thank you very much. I will be quick. Thank you very much. It appears from Mr. Lyons' comments that all of the blame lies with Sinn Féin. Does he not accept that there's any blame at all apportioned to his own party and the actions of his ministerial colleagues and friends who have failed to answer the questions that the public want answered of them, and that they refuse to stand aside, that they refuse to give any answers? I'm not an apologist for Sinn Féin, but is it any wonder they and the rest of us are totally and utterly sceptical of what you're
doing? Order.
I thank the member for his intervention. I am not blaming Sinn Féin. I'm saying that they're the ones walking away. This isn't about RHI anymore. They have walked away for other reasons. That is the point that I am making. That's why I want to have this public inquiry, so that people can see for themselves. But of course,
ask the member to conclude his remarks.
It's difficult for us to support this when they're calling for the First Minister to step aside. That is not what should have happened. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you. Thank you, pantomime crowd, for that introduction. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, this is an extremely serious issue, one that the seriousness of which cannot be underestimated or wished away. It is our responsibility as elected representatives to ensure the best outcomes for the people who send us here. And it, yes?
The member just said there that this is something that people can't underestimate. Would he accept that his party have actually underestimated the public anger on this over the past month? I think the frustration is here today that the party is here calling for and endorsing a public inquiry. If the party had acted much sooner at the beginning of December and acknowledged and recognised the problems and actually at that stage put a public inquiry in place, we wouldn't be in this mess.
The member has an additional minute.
Thank you. I take the point that you're making. I don't underestimate the seriousness of this situation at all. I don't underestimate the anger that's out there about this issue at all, because I speak to my constituents and I know that people are very angry and people want answers. There have been various reactions to the situation as it has developed, and my friend Gordon Lyons from East Antrim referenced this. The other partner in government, Sinn Féin, asked for an inquiry, and we acceded to that because we wanted the truth to be established. And I still do want the truth to be established. I still do want there to be a full, open, public inquiry into all of these matters, because it does no good to any of us for the reputation of politics to be maligned. Sinn Féin were offered, they offered us terms of inquiry. They were agreed. They asked for a public inquiry. That was agreed. The sole sticking point from Sinn Féin's perspective was that they were demanding on a plate the head of the First Minister. From our perspective, that was unacceptable, not only because the people of Northern Ireland, not 7 months ago, elected her to the office, but it was unacceptable because in the run-in to the debate on the 19th of December, it had become very apparent that those who were making the call for the First Minister to step aside were not doing so from a position of impartiality. We're not doing so from a position of, oh, this is just like in the civil service where you're sent on gardening leave. It is quite clear that those who were demanding the First Minister step aside were doing so because, just briefly, Andy, let me finish my point. They were doing so largely because they were motivated by a desire to score a political point and to claim a political scalp. I'm happy to give way to Mr. Allen.
Would the member share his concerns of his party colleague, Mr. Dunn, when he raised the dual role responsibility for this RHI policy of Daddy and Ofgem? But would he share my concerns that if the policy was right in the first place, we likely wouldn't be in this scenario?
I absolutely agree that the management and oversight of the scheme was fundamentally flawed, and it is important that in a public inquiry we establish the facts around that. I agree with what Dr. Farrey said with regard to the need for two pillars, to be a two-pillar approach going forward. One is obviously mitigation. And it is essential that the money that has been staked on this scheme, as much as possible, is clawed back. It is absolutely essential that that happens, because that is committed expenditure that could be spent on other more valuable, more useful things. But it ill behoves a party that can't even bring themselves to be in the chamber. They defend their abstentionist policy in terms of Westminster. Now they're actually abstaining from Stormont as well. It ill behoves a party that can't even bring themselves to be in the chamber and who, through their behaviour over welfare reform, cost the people of Northern Ireland £174 million in real money, not in committed expenditure, in real money, over a period of 2 years, to lecture — I've only got a minute and a half left — to lecture any of the others. One of the issues that has been raised by others in terms of the package that's been outlined by the Minister relates to the breaking of contracts, and this has been portrayed as a contract being broken. I think that's potentially a simplistic assessment, because what we're dealing with here is actually the granting of aid under a statutory scheme, and it's not the same thing as a contract. So I'm hopeful that those issues can be overcome. In relation to accountability, I think it's absolutely vital that all of the information, all of it, every email, every letter, every exchange, is brought into the public domain, all of it, for everyone to see and make a balanced assessment in terms of who was responsible for what and how we got to this juncture. Thus far, that has not been the case, and we have had a drip feed of information from various sources, and I don't think that that is conducive to the public good or conducive to informing people as to what is actually going on and what was actually going on.
I ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. From my perspective, I want all of this brought into the public domain and sorted, because it is in none of our interests.
Member's time is up.
That the reputation of politics should be blackened. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Ms. Bradley, Sinead Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise on behalf of the SDLP, and speaking to the motion in front of us today, I want to make clear that this motion represents the clear clarity of thinking that has been missing from the DUP Sinn Féin executive to date. Major mistakes have happened, nobody doubts that. There are even suggestions of fraudulent activity discussed yesterday at the Economy Committee meeting. Access to information has been deliberately denied to people in this House and the general public. In fact, I did put a question to the Minister some weeks ago asking for a geographical breakdown of the recipients of the RHI by district electoral area. I did so because I recognise there are many legitimate applicants to this scheme who are in receipt of money in a very legitimate way. We need to be sensitive to those people, and we are not hanging anybody out to dry. Likewise, we were not after a head on a plate. Yes, I will give way.
Well, obviously, the DUP must maybe scared of what I was going to say. But specifically in that regard of legitimate applicants and legitimate users, what hasn't been mentioned, especially from this side of the House, is one of the major concerns that has been brought forward is the 886 applications that were made in a six-week period in October and November. That's 147 average installations per week. And what was different about this scheme? These burners had to be in place before the application could be made.
Member has an additional minute.
Thank you. I fully agree. And yes, I accept that point. Information has been deliberately withheld from ourselves and others in this House. And I have to find out via the media, it is certainly not that the opposition have not been asking the questions we have. At every opportunity, I will not give way because my time is limited. We have been asking the questions and the answers have not been forthcoming. Why is the reason? What was there to hide? No intention to give way for the remainder. There is little point in me speaking today to the dysfunction of the outgoing DUP Sinn Féin executive. That is now clearly a matter of public record, and the public are very wise to that. And it is a legacy of their own making. My only regret is the damage that it has done to the institutions here in Northern Ireland whilst they were playing their choreographed love-in, and conveniently then, when a time suited them, others left this chamber calling for an election, beating their chests before they ever thought it important to stop the hemorrhaging of public finances, before they thought it important to lay bare to the public the facts around this scheme. Why have they done that? That is a serious question, and there is nobody here today to answer it. And I do regret that is the space we have all landed ourselves in. So basically, anybody at the outset of this government may very well have asked the question, how long could this government survive without a moderate voice, without some clear thinking from the moderate parties? Well, now we have our answer. Today, however, the SDLP continue to step up where others have failed. We present to you a motion that is in the public interest. It talks to what should happen, proper governance. This is how it looks. This is what should have happened. When others had the gift, while it is very laudable that they say, yes, we did want an inquiry, yes, we're up for an inquiry, you had the gift of creating such an inquiry and you did not do it. You had your partners in government who the relationship was so cosy, and I could quote many things that would be cringeworthy at this stage. What is the point? Let's look at the public interests here. I'm sorry, I'll just finish on this because I'm conscious of time. I do believe that the motion in front of us today speaks to the public interest. It is not about politicking. It is not about playing one off against the other. It is about taking a responsible action that has been missing. And I call on every politician in Northern Ireland here today who has a right to do so to put the public interest before their own party interests, and present themselves in the lobby here today in support of this motion if they are genuine in their calls to see the fiasco brought to a swift end and the money directed to our hospitals, education and other places where it is so badly needed. Words are hollow when an opportunity is presented to you and you do not take it. If you suggest you want to represent yourself to be a member of this House, then you must search your soul now and ask, what am I doing? What am I doing before I walk out those doors to make sure the public interest is being served? There are many, I suggest, are doing absolutely nothing, only electioneering, spinning, and trying to create something of an illusion that they are fit for government. The political Febreze that has been spread throughout this building has somehow blurred people's vision on what has actually happened.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
I will indeed, and I again repeat my call. I ask all responsible politicians to make their way through the lobbies today and put their vote where their comments have been to date.
Thank you. I call Mr. Paul Frew.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I rise to talk about this issue, as we have on many occasions over the last number of months. And one of the things that I've watched this with quite a lot of interest, something I'm passionate about, is energy policy throughout the world, not just here in Northern Ireland. So it's something I've watched with intrigue and interest. But I've also been distraught at the white noise that has been created, the sensationalism that has been created, and the bloodletting that has been created, because all of that has ensured that we don't get this resolved in a timely fashion. What was going on since it was discovered that there was an issue with RHA? There have been independent inspections. Up to now, there's been about 300, I think. We have had a detailed assessment. The ministers have had a detailed assessment of legal advice of what they can do to fix it. But we've also had an ongoing public accounts committee, which the chair has eloquently spoke about today, not about the investigation, but his understanding of the issue. And we've had the audit report before that, the audit office report before that. So it is unfair and untrue to suggest that politicians or ministers were not doing something about this issue. If some of the members only realised it late autumn, well, that's more to do with them, more to say about them than anyone else. But it is vitally important that we put in place measures to manage the unintended pressure this scheme is placing, and will continue to place if it's not fixed. Let me stress, there are many who legitimately entered this scheme in good faith, who may well now be caught up in a media storm. Businesses who rely on their good name, their good faith, their reputation and credibility could now be caught up in a media storm, a sensationalist media storm all over the head of this and the hyperbole that's been created. Indeed, let's try and get something done in a timely fashion. That's what the minister brought forward yesterday. Yes, I will.
And I take entirely his point. I think, in the interests of public inquiry, and I'm sure he'll not dispute this, that those people who are legitimately conducting their business have absolutely nothing to fear from a public inquiry.
Member for his
member is an additional minute.
Yes, I thank the member for his contribution, but it's not. Yes, I will.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. The member's right to say that people have nothing to fear from a legitimate public inquiry. But legitimate businesses conducting themselves in a legitimate way do have plenty to fear when their names being dragged across the airwaves.
And that's the point I was going to make. Thank you for making that. It's not the public inquiry that anyone fears. It's the sensationalism of some sections of our media on this issue. And that can be very damaging. We've already had one instance where one good business, has been dragged through the mud. They happen to sell a trademark car. Unfairly. And that will continue in a drip-feed fashion. But there has to be responsibility in this House for mistakes made. There has to be, and that has to happen. But look what has happened. No, I'm going to run out of time. I'm really, really sorry, and I would if I had more time. Look what has happened over the last couple of months. There has been a drip-feed of sensationalism by our media, and some of our politicians in this very House have been caught up in a blood fest, a feeding frenzy, wanting someone's head on a platter. Now, we're here, no, I can't, I'm sorry, I do apologise. We're here to serve our people
and when mistakes happen, to fix them. But people called on Arlene Foster to come to this chamber to explain. She came to this chamber to explain. You walked out. You walked out. And you hurt the credibility of this place even further. You called for Arlene to go to the PAC. Unprecedented. Arlene Foster agreed. The goalposts were moved yet again. Sinn Féin were receiving pressure from their Nationalist competitors. They got themselves on a hook and they couldn't get themselves off the hook. They are very mindful. Sinn Féin are very mindful. They come in here very confident. They're going through something of a bit of a crisis. There's a bit of a meltdown and it's right into the very heartlands. They're scared because for the first time they have a socialist left flank and they don't know how to deal with it. They're looking at a new leader for the SDLP and they don't really know how to deal with it. Let's face it, let's say it as it is. But what Sinn Féin's actions have created is the inability now of this House. We can't now finish a public accounts inquiry. It can't be finished because Sinn Féin resignation. And let me just say this at the end. Look, put this in context. This is a projected spend of £480 million over 20 years, a projected spend that could be fixed. What about all the politicking last year on welfare reform that cost our people £173 million? That was the SDLP and Sinn Féin created that. What about the very fact that when
ask
you resign,
the member to conclude his
you can't
remarks.
Have a budget? That will cost this country in July £600 million in 1 year. £600 million in 1 year.
Member's time is up.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Mr. Jonathan Bell.
Deputy Speaker. I think the gravity of the situation that is faced before Northern Ireland today, I don't think can be overestimated. Terminally ill children are being sent home from hospital, are being offered a hospital far away from their homes. We have a ward in the Ulster Hospital, nurses ill, no money to pay for bank nurses, and the outcome of that was the ward was closed. At the same time, as we know that there is serious and grave offence caused by the renewable heat incentive. And, Deputy Speaker, we are called to this House to be servants of the people. The people are not our servants. And the truth of what has happened in this scheme is a priority above all. As I said yesterday, I only spoke out after 20 years in elected office when journalists were able to prove to me that requests were made for me to speak, but misinformation was being given out that I was unavailable. And where there was an instruction given to make sure that I wasn't called before the Public Accounts Committee. And Mr. Speaker, people have asked and the media has asked when I will say again what I said in this House yesterday. Let me make it clear when I will say again what I said in this House yesterday. I will say it to the judge-led public inquiry. I will say it exactly as I said it to this House, because it is honest and truthful, and I will say it to the judge under oath. There were serious concerns with this scheme. There was serious, and there is evidence available, which shows that special advisers interfered to stop the scheme. The reduction in the tariff, when we moved to do that, which could have solved so many of the problems under my watch. I came into office and had this scheme closed within 10 months as minister. But during that time, there was an opportunity to reduce the tariff. And we have seen what happened when the tariff was reduced. The massive cost to the public was not there. But there was interference from special advisers, as has been confirmed to me by our civil service, as there is evidence, because I kept records of it, to show that. And that's a serious concern and has to be for everyone in Northern Ireland. Yeah.
Is the member alluding to the special advisers were actually involved in driving up the spike, which happened in October and November?
Thank you very much. What I'm saying is that when the opportunity came before me to reduce the tariff, which was the advice that I was then being given, special advisers interfered to delay the reduction in the tariff. That's confirmed to me by the top people in the civil service. It's confirmed to me by the evidence that I have. And I've told the truth. And I've been suspended from a party I've given decades of service to, while much more serious things have occurred.
Grateful to the member giving way. Would he actually recognise, as a former minister, that special advisers actually have no authority within the government system? They act solely on the direction of their ministers, and if they're acting independently without that authority, the minister is still nevertheless accountable for those actions.
I take full accountability for my actions, but I didn't appoint my special advisor. My special advisor was appointed by the party, and when other special advisors interfered to stop the reduction in the tariff, the advice given to me by the civil service and by my permanent secretary, and is on record, was that because of that, I could not go ahead and reduce the tariff as I wished to do. Now, I have told the truth. The evidence, just I've 1.5 minutes left. I've told the truth and I've put it before the public. And there is a way throughout all of this. It is a fact, not only that, but also that within half an hour of me closing the scheme, my ministerial instruction was countermanded by Stormont Castle. There is a case of justice that lies at the heart of this. The public interest deserves to know who benefited. I'm not going to go into the speculation of which special advisor is a boiler, which one doesn't, which one could have upped the yet, which one doesn't. That is for a judge to decide. But make no mistake, what I told the BBC on one occasion and what I said in the House yesterday, I will tell a judge under oath the exact same information. We serve the public. Well over 1,000 have sent cards to me, letters to me, emails to me. I've had 4 people opposing me, 2 by calls, 1 by text, and 1 by email, to the best of my knowledge as I stand. The public, I think, by a percentage of 50,000 to 1 of those who have contacted me, are overwhelmingly telling me, tell the truth. And I have no doubt today too, and I finish with this, Deputy Speaker, that having told the truth, if Dr. Paisley was here today, he wouldn't leave me sitting on my own. He would be sitting beside me.
Will the member give way?
Sorry, the time's up, sorry.
Order. I call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Certainly, from the Alliance Party's perspective, it is important that we get to the bottom of this RHI scandal, this RHI debacle, which has completely and utterly removed public confidence in the institutions of government here at Stormont, and also has undermined the credibility, in my view, of the two political parties who are and formed or have formed the government in this place. So it is vitally important that we get to the end point of this discussion. It is vitally important, as Mr. Bell says, that we get to that public inquiry and that it is all there, and in the terms of this motion, that there will be no impediment to hold back the results of this inquiry. Can I also, Mr. Deputy Speaker, welcome some of the words that have been spoken here this morning by some of the DUP members. Mr. Stalford has certainly recognised the need to end the drip feed. In fact, he also said that RHI should be brought into the public domain. And I welcome that. It's just sad on reflection that it has taken his party and perhaps some of his colleagues who still wish to resist some of the elements of this, that they haven't managed to bring themselves to that point. But I do recognise that there are some who actually feel the weight of responsibility of the situation that their party has placed them in. Perhaps we're beginning to see that some of these DUP members are beginning to recognise the challenge that this has brought to democracy in Northern Ireland, the challenge that this has brought to openness and to probity in Northern Ireland, and that just because it can no longer be party before all else, it has to be the public come first, the public have a right to know, the public have a right to see, and we have a right to, and we have a privilege to deliver open and transparent government here in Northern Ireland.
Would the member give way?
Yes, I will.
Thank you for giving way. Would the member agree with me, in the interests of good governance, that it's important to ascertain who made the determinations not to open the risk registers in Derry and in the AFP? And was it because of Westminster picking up the tab? And would he also agree with me that the concerns raised here today would be that the Permanent Secretary did not move to mitigate?
I would agree with... Thank you, and I thank Mr. Palmer for his comments. Yes, of course, I would agree that there are many, many questions that need to be answered, and that they can only be answered in one place, and that is in an impartial, appropriately set inquiry into these matters. I know Mr. Agnew wanted to come in, and I'm happy to give way to him as well.
I thank Mr. Dixon for giving way, and it's coming back to his point about the DUP's newfound position and support for a public inquiry. They made that position while they were still in government, and indeed while Sinn Féin were still taking their own in government. They could have then, through one of their ministers, proposed a public inquiry at the executive and forced Sinn Féin's hand and forced them to either agree to it or deny it. They chose not to do that, so their claims are disingenuous.
I wouldn't disagree with that, but... Yes?
Would the member agree with me that had a DUP minister done that, Mr. Agnew and others would be precisely the people leading the charge saying that such an inquiry was corrupted because it was a DUP minister who had done it? You wouldn't have been happy with anything we would have said?
No. I think from my perspective that's certainly not my stance. Any minister is free and able to bring an appropriate inquiry, a free, open, public inquiry under the Inquiries Act to this chamber. They will not find us wanting in delivering that inquiry. I don't mind which minister brings it, whether it's one of the ex-ministers of Sinn Féin who aren't even here this morning, or whether it's one of your own. Yes, of course you'll receive criticism for it, but the actual thing is to do the right thing, and the right thing is to have that inquiry. It is still not too late to have that inquiry. It is still not too late to have that inquiry. You can call that inquiry today. Your ministers can set that inquiry up today. You do not require the consent of your partners in government to do it.
That if a DUP minister was to do that, you would support it?
The Alliance Party, of course, will support a public inquiry in accordance with the motion that is in front of this House today. That's why I expect you to vote for this motion. I will.
The member also agreed the Justice Minister could do it at any time as well, if she so desired.
The technical nature of how and why and the nuts and bolts of a public inquiry are a very interesting debate. But what the public want to know today is, when will a judge-led open public inquiry commence here in Northern Ireland? They don't really mind who brings it. They want it to, that what they want is it brought on so that people like Mr. Bell and others can come to the House, come to that inquiry and give their answers, and the public can finally get their truth. That's what they're looking for. That's what they deserve. That is what Northern Ireland wants today. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I congratulate Mr. Dixon on achieving a record number of interventions? I call Mr. Philip Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I appreciate this is a long and complex motion, but I want to focus on a couple of key clauses. Firstly, the motion highlights mounting public concern, damage caused to public confidence. These words don't do justice to the anger and frustration that people genuinely feel about this scandal. This scandal, and it is a scandal, as we've heard from Mr. Bell, it's brought down these institutions, it's led to an unnecessary and expensive election, unwanted by the public, and it's damaged the reputation of Northern Ireland nationally and internationally. It could and should have been avoided. Even as late as Christmas, the then First Minister could have avoided this current crisis by not taking the arrogant and high-handed approach to this scandal and taking her share of the responsibility for this failure. I believe the Department Permanent Secretary, Andrew McCormick, said at the Economy Committee yesterday that the mistake in the original scheme was a policy mistake. Who makes policy? Ministers make policy. He was very clear where the responsibility lies.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Thank you very much. I just would take us back then to a comment that was made earlier by Mr Dunn, who said that there was no proper management in place, no management review by Detty, and the minister at that time was indeed Arlene Foster in Detty.
Members, an additional minute.
Thank you. I thank you for the intervention. I totally agree. The changes that are now being proposed by the economy minister yesterday basically put in the tiering and controls that were inexplicably removed by Arlene Foster under her watch as Deputy Minister, as you rightly say. And if, as Mr McCormick suggests, and he should know, that it was a policy mistake, then it reinforces Mrs Foster's responsibility. Yeah, well, yeah.
Also accept that in the evidence by the officials to the committee, they clearly indicated that their recommendation to the minister, to Minister Foster at that time, was that these safeguards weren't in place. So it wasn't that Minister Foster, while as economy minister, removed this. It was a recommendation of officials that they were absent from it.
Yeah. I take that point on board, but the bottom line is, if we'd have taken on the GB policy, we wouldn't be in this mess where we are today. And the question is, how does the Assembly and the public get answers on this? Where is the public inquiry, as Mr Dixon says, that we were promised by Arlene Foster last Wednesday? Nothing again. And accountability seems to be punted down the road, at best after an election. How very convenient. I'll now move on to the cost of this scandal. The motion again calls on the Ministers of Economy and Finance to bring forward a plan to arrest the liability to the public purse. Now, on the 4th of January this year, Mrs Foster said in the Belfast Telegraph, and I quote, "A lot has been made about the potential overspend. I want to make sure that doesn't happen. We plan to bring that potential cost down to zero. There will be no overspend." I hope the Economy Minister will continue to stand over that commitment. But I refer, just to give some context to the cost, to a tweet that Sam McBride issued last week. And I have to say, this isn't about a media storm. I pay tribute to the role that the media has played in this process and actually exposed this scandal in all its detail. And what he said in his tweet, quite simply, was that RHI has cost taxpayers £3 million since the BBC Spotlight programme, or £20.5 million under this executive, and £32.4 million since a whistleblower warned OFM-DFM in January 2016. And of course, it will cost a further £6.5 million at least until these regulations come into effect on the 1st of April. Plus, of course, there are other costs the department will still be liable for. So much for a zero cost. But why have we had to wait until now for action? Is it the thought of facing the electorate that is focusing minds? The government have known about this for at least a year, if not longer. The Northern Ireland Audit Report was published in July. And why were proposals only brought at the last minute? All, I believe, to try and avoid awkward questions on the doorsteps. But certainly we'll welcome anything that will plug the £85,000 daily cost of this scandal and protect Northern Ireland's taxpayers. We brought forward the adjournment yesterday so that we have more time to effectively scrutinise the Minister's proposals, and I hope we will see a proper business case. You'll have time to allow the Examiner of Statutory Rules to look in detail at the proposals and to ensure that there is a sound legal foundation for the legislation. The last thing we want is a legal challenge, although it now appears that this is already in the waiting. As my colleague Steve Aiken said yesterday, I hope the Minister will stake his position on the legal validity of his proposals. So in conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, I suppose we should be grateful that the arrogant response to this scandal has started to wane. The penny appears to have finally dropped, that the public anger in response to this scandal is genuine and widely held, and the usual tactics to distract attention will not work. The last-minute action brought yesterday appears designed to be a short-term fix ahead of an election campaign. And while we hope that public money can be saved, it does not get the DUP off the hook. We must have a public inquiry. Finally, Mr Deputy Speaker, this whole mess is summed up by the recent fire in Fermanagh. 8 boilers and a shed overheating. It is a scandal, incompetence at best. Northern Ireland deserves so much better. People at least will have the opportunity now to pass their judgment on this scandal. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Call Mr Edwin Poots.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak on this issue. In terms of it, I think that there is a lot of people who have a culpability in this issue. And if we start, we have two deputy ministers. We have the officials who drafted it. We have the specialists who were brought in, the specialist consultants who were brought in. Ofgem. We have the Assembly Committee who overseen it. And everybody has a culpability in that. And I think for that, you know, we owe the public an apology in devising a scheme that wasn't fit for purpose. And in that respect, I think that is an important message that needs to be get out there. We devised a scheme that wasn't fit for purpose. We regret that, and we now need to fix it. That should be the focus of this Assembly and everyone within it, that we need to fix it, we need to rectify the mistake and move on. Yes, Mr. Rich.
The Member has given a list of those who had some direct involvement. Would he add those who have occupied the position of Finance Minister during that period, because they would have been alerted to the difficulties and could have taken action to correct it, and also the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, who should have been coordinating or executive?
Member has an extra minute.
Yes, I would, and the entire executive, for that matter, and the spads who are involved in it. Everybody has a culpability in this. But this, and this is where I'm coming to, this particular motion targets one individual. One individual, the First Minister, who was, of course, Arlene Foster. And Arlene Foster did not devise a scheme. She was presented with a scheme. She didn't ask for it to be changed by the civil servants from the UK one. She was presented with a scheme saying this was the best way forward for Northern Ireland. And she accepted the advice of the Energy Division after it went through all of the specialist consultants and all of that there and Ofgem in devising it. But here we have this fixation with this hate campaign against Arlene Foster. Let me say very clearly, Arlene Foster brought in tens of thousands of jobs in conjunction with InvestNI to Northern Ireland over her period as a minister. Northern Ireland had the highest success rate in the United Kingdom of bringing inward investment. The only place outside of it that was beating us was the south-east of England. Every other region in Northern Ireland, or every other region in the United Kingdom, was trailing in the wake of Northern Ireland whenever Arlene Foster was the Deputy Minister out there bringing jobs back to Northern Ireland.
Give way?
But the members are fixated on this hate campaign against Arlene Foster.
Thank the member for giving way. One of the questions that have been posed today, one by Sinead Bradley and also by Robin Swan, now, none of the two are in the chamber. They've had to obviously go out. They're maybe as busy as me, I don't know. But one of the issues that was raised was, what about the 880 applications that was created in the run in the autumn? Now, as if it was some sort of sinister plot, it could have been as simply as something as Amber Rudd closing the rocks a year early, which then created the run because people were concerned that RHI would close early. And of course, the minister at that time was John Bell, and he knows all about the rock issue at that time.
Well, it's absolutely true that Amber Rudd did move early, and that did create all sorts of issues and problems, and there was issues about wind energy as well, that we had to close early. And had that not been the case, and I know that Mr. Frew worked very hard to ensure that it wasn't the case, and indeed Mr. Madlone, then we would have been in a worse position again. Ms. Armstrong, you.
I thank the member very much for giving way, and he talks about the good work that Mrs. Foster has done as First Minister. I would expect no less of her doing her job. However, if she did her job as Deputy, and she saw, she should have saw the difference between the GB scheme and the Northern Ireland scheme, because if you're over the jot and tittle, that is exactly what happens. That doesn't seem to be the case. Does the member accept that?
And the member gets back to this, you know, get rid of Arlene campaign. You know, Ofgem didn't say it. The officials didn't say it. The specialist consultants didn't say it. The committee didn't say it, with the Alliance members on it. Nobody else saying it. Nobody's saying it. But Arlene Foster was the one that has to take the hit on it all. Arlene Foster brought in tens of thousands of jobs as Deputy Minister. She was a hugely successful Deputy Minister and has been a hugely successful First Minister. And the hate campaign brought about by all of the other members here needs to stop.
They need to stop the hate campaign point against Arlene Foster.
Point of order.
Point of order, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, Mr. Poots would like to reflect on his comment that the Alliance Party had a member on the Deputy Committee. For the record, the Alliance Party did not have a member on the Deputy Committee.
Happy to have that clarification inserted, and that is not an issue. In terms of this, we are happy for a public inquiry, because with all of this, he say, she say. I do not want a public inquiry of the nature of Chilcot or of the nature of Savile, and I explained that in the last speech that I made on this issue. We are happy for full public investigation to be led by a judge. We want it done quickly. I would love to have the information out before an election and stop all of this, he said, she said, trial by media and the hate campaign being imposed on us by the other politicians against Arlene Foster, because she is much too successful a politician for their liking. She is far too popular with the public. Member, so let's damn Arlene Foster and get rid of her because she is much too great a politician for you to contend with.
Call Ms. Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And for the record, Mr. Poots, I don't hate Arlene Foster. I don't hate anyone. The timeline in terms of the introduction of this scheme and the deliberate intervention to alter the scheme and to remove the cost controls signed off by the Minister, Arlene Foster, is well documented. The number of warnings personally given to Arlene Foster and given to the department in question are well documented. And the DUP, Mr. Speaker, talks about understanding public anger. They talk about sharing public anger. But what they have refused to do is to take responsibility for the part that they have played in it. What they have done is they have engaged in a blame game. It was a whistleblower's fault. It was a civil servant's fault. It was a consultant's fault. It was the media's fault, and still is when we listen to contributions thus far. It's the opposition's fault. And those who were raising valid questions about who knew what, when, and what did they do, who is responsible and should be held accountable, we were accused of misogyny. And Mr. Frew accuses us today of wanting to engage in a blood fest. On top of this, we have Mr. Bell's account of events versus Mr. Foster's account of events. And wherever the truth lies, and a public inquiry will determine where the truth lies, the unquestionable truth is that this is a DUP-created mess of epic proportions. As Mr. Smith, in one second, as Mr. Smith has outlined, and as Sam McBride tweeted, this DUP scandal has cost the taxpayer £3 million in spotlight. It has cost the taxpayer over £32 million since the whistleblower warned the Office of First Minister and Deputy First Minister in January 2016. And it continues to cost the taxpayer £85,000 every day. A second unquestionable truth in all of this is that this situation has been fuelled and pushed to this brink because of the arrogance of the DUP in their response and their defiance to be held to account. They have, as other members have said, begun to finally realise and waken up to this fact. Hence the shift in tone, the move to being more contrite, the U-turn articulated so blatantly today by Mr. Poots that now they're in favour of a public inquiry. The third unquestionable truth, and then I will let members in, is that under this executive, this scandal has cost the taxpayer over £20 million. The DUP created this mess, but they are partners in government with Sinn Féin. There is joint authority and there is joint responsibility. The executive parties knew about this scandal for well over a year, and some of us could argue much longer than that, and yet they said nothing. One second, they said nothing. But then they became very vocal and frantic, only when the Spotlight programme threw this into the public domain. And Sinn Féin in particular only became vocal when they could see the public backlash. Because up to that point, what they did do was they tried to keep it from the public. That's the truth. I'll let in Mr. Nesbitt.
I thank Ms. Mallon for letting me in. She will have heard Mr. Poots twice enumerate a long list of those who allegedly missed the flaw in the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme, but on neither occasion did he include special advisers in that list. Would she... I didn't hear him say special advisers. No, I did not hear you. I didn't hear you say special advisers. I didn't hear special advisers. And so the question is, does she agree with me that that raises the question of whether they missed it or they exploited it?
The member has an extra minute.
All departments need to be put under scrutiny. All ministers, all special advisers. That's why the SDLP has consistently called for a public inquiry. Because we have nothing to fear from the questions of who knew what, when and what did they do about it. And in respect of Sinn Féin, Mr Speaker, joint partners in government who knew about this for a year, who said nothing until the public started to get very angry about it. On the airwaves today, a member of Sinn Féin described and derided this debate on an issue of such critical importance as meaningless discussions. And I think it sums it up and it tells the public who is really and genuinely exercised and outraged by all of this. But what is very clear, Mr Speaker, is that we will see attempt after attempt to distract from all of this. Because we could be several weeks into a public inquiry. We could have saved the public £85,000 every day. And people need to face up to the fact that when you're in power, the buck stops with you. You are responsible. That's why you get the big money. And you should be held to account. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
The member has... I call Mr Jerry Mullen.
Mr Speaker. Mr Speaker, I welcome this opportunity to participate in today's debate concerning these very hastily brought forward regulations which attempts to mitigate spend on the botched Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme. I don't need to remind anyone that the unregulated and uncapped RHI cash for ice scheme is indeed the biggest scandal ever to hit this country. The biggest scandal ever in the history of devolution, which has left a monumental hole, a black hole in the Stormont finances to the tune of £500 million. This scandal has driven these institutions to collapse and our government to collapse. Make no mistake about it, Mr Speaker, the ousted First Minister Arlene Foster implemented the scheme and under the concept of ministerial responsibility, she is culpable. There was a flawed tariff in place. There was no cost controls or progress reviews. There were limited inspections and very little regulation. And finally, there was a complete failure to act on a whistleblower's warning as far back as 2013. And 4 years later, Mr Speaker, it is the DUP who are bringing these proposals to us in what I regard as merely a simple exercise in face-saving. But Mr Speaker, I ask how many millions of taxpayers' money has been wasted since the scheme was introduced? We know some 30 million has been squandered this financial year so far. But the RHI scandal goes much further. There are some very serious allegations made around corruption at the heart of the executive. And Mr Speaker, it's my belief that we do not have by any means all the information concerning the RHI scheme out in the open. Departmental documents have been hidden from view, even from the PAC committee investigation. We do not know who the recipients of the scheme are, who benefited, and whether supporters of a certain political party reaped heavy rewards from the RHI scheme. And it is ironic, is it not, Mr Speaker, that the Economy Minister, Mr Hamilton, he seemed very content. I am sorry, I will not give any interventions because you have had long enough to say and do the right thing. You have not done so to this point, and you will certainly not take advantage of me to make any political points. And it is ironic, Mr Speaker, that the Economy Minister, Mr Hamilton, He seemed very content to remove regulations yesterday, which are open to legal challenge yet, and we will not publish it, and he will not publish the details of the recipients of the scheme due to the prospect of the same legal challenge. What has the DUP got to hide? These are all very serious questions, Mr. Speaker, that have gone unanswered so far, and the public deserve that they be answered, and they be answered immediately. That is why, Mr. Speaker, the SDLP from day one called for the First Minister to step aside for a public inquiry into this botched energy scheme devoid of any political influence or conflict of interest. After all, this scheme will cost the taxpayer £85,000 per day or £600,000 a week. What could this money do for our failing hospitals? For our GPs, we have heard only this morning of the closure of a GP surgery, I think it was in County Down, I'm not sure, but what could that money have not done to help in those situations? Very quickly.
Yes. Would the member, I'm sure that if the members would just hold on the far side, they'll respect the point I'm going to make, while supporting entirely that, yes, the First Minister should step aside during a public inquiry. Likewise, I'm sure the member will support the view that any other minister giving evidence about his or her department should likewise step aside while they give the evidence to that public inquiry.
Member has an extra minute.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for his comments, and I agree totally. But I was asking about what this money could possibly have been used for if it hadn't been squandered to the extent that it was. The hospitals or GPs they're facing crisis point, or the dilapidated conditions of our roads. We have recently, in my area, work's been done on the railway line, which caused the roads around my area to be churned into quagmires. It has yet to be resolved and sorted and fixed. Money like that could be used for local projects, local issues, and better spent. But, Mr. Speaker, Sinn Féin are no martyrs either in all of this. They talk about equality, a Bill of Rights, and dealing with the past.
Member, conclude his remarks.
Yet they agreed to a programme for government. Mr. Speaker, as winding, I thought I had 10 minutes. Not winding, okay. Well, Mr. Speaker, I will conclude then, and I will say
Member's
that...
Member's time is up.
Okay,
call
thank you.
Call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Mr. Speaker, we have two possible scenarios. Scenario one, Arlene Foster steps aside for a temporary period as First Minister. Scenario two, she refuses, but the result is she's forced out of her position as First Minister, as has transpired. In scenario one, we could have had an agreed inquiry into the RHI scandal. We could have had an agreed proposal in terms of protecting public money, and we could have had stable government. I'll give way in a moment. What we have is scenario two, where, as I say, Arlene Foster is still not the First Minister, whether it's temporary or permanent, we'll see. We have a proposal from Simon Hamilton on protecting public money that I would argue is dodgy at best. We have no inquiry, although I think it's increasingly unlikely, but we do still have ministers. We still have that opportunity. And we have institutions which are on the brink of collapse. And I have to ask the question, given that both these scenarios, Arlene Foster is at least temporarily no longer First Minister, what has Arlene Foster's intransigence achieved? Why are we facing political crisis today? I'll give way to Mr. Stafford.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. The member is engaging, I fear, in a rewriting of history, because when this was debated, the SDLP motion that was brought forward to exclude the First Minister from office, a device that hinged on a measure that was created for when people were suspected of engaging, or their proxies were suspected of engaging, in paramilitary behaviour. That was prejudging any inquiry, and the member knows that. Now, post December the 19th, the member and others are pretending that they were engaging in fairness, when the truth of the matter is, if not necessarily in his case, but certainly in others, the intent was not fair, it was malicious.
I thank the member,
member has an extra minute.
And I would argue and have argued that Arlene Foster could have taken the lead. She could have done as her predecessor, Peter Robinson, did, and actually say, I will step aside. I will take that decision. Now, I don't agree with the method of inquiry in the Peter Robinson case, but isn't it a sad scenario when I am saying, you remember the good old days when we had Peter Robinson? There was an honourable guy. I think that's a worrying time. I think that's a worrying time. But I do ask the question: what has been achieved? What did this insistence on saying no, this insistence on refusing to step aside, what did it achieve? And what all that was being asked was that Arlene Foster do what would be expected of any employee who was under suspicion. All that was being asked was indeed what Mr. Bell was expected to do by his party: suspension without prejudice, pending investigation. But Arlene Foster is no ordinary employee. She is the leader of unionism. Some leadership. This is what it has led to. Assembly on the brink of collapse. Institutions that have been worked hard to get up and running, that Northern Ireland's future depends on. No budget, no programme for government, no solution to RHI. That's what that leadership has achieved. And that's where we are, Mr. Speaker. I seek to be positive. I seek to be constructive in my contribution since I've been elected to this House. And today, I've sought to do that following the debate yesterday on Simon Hamilton's proposals, which I've been clear my party cannot accept. I've written to the Finance Minister today and asked him to investigate the possibility of a windfall tax. The Green Party is proposing that there be a 100% tax on any payment to RHI recipients over and above the cost of wood pellets. This would ensure there be no incentive to produce heat without use, and that there would be no cash for ash. The proposal, in my view, and my advice I've been given, would be legal because it does not retrospectively change the contracts of the recipients, but would do what any government is entitled to do, introduce a tax on the windfall payments that they have received. I believe it is fair, I believe it is legal, and I believe it is a long-term solution, unlike the one-year proposal we had from the Economy Minister yesterday. We still have time, albeit a very short and very limited time, to protect public money. And I would call on the Finance
Member conclude his remarks.
And to work with his colleagues to achieve that.
Call Mr. Gerry Carroll.
I need to remind this House of how deeply angry and frustrated the public are that £600 million of public money has been wasted on a scheme which was designed from the start to fund private companies to get cash for ash. And when we put this in context, in the wake of Red Sky, in the wake of NAMA and the whole scandal around the Social Investment Fund, it's clear that corruption is at the very heart of Stormont. And in the last few weeks, Mr. Speaker, I've been speaking to people around my constituency, knocking doors, and people are well aware of the corruption that exists in this place, and they're absolutely fed up with it. And they're fed up, Mr. Speaker, being told there's nothing that they can do, nothing that can be done around waiting lists in our hospitals, yet people have to wait 2, 3, 4 years to get even the most basic operations. fed up when they are forced to go out and strike for a respectable wage, be they teachers, nurses or public sector workers, and fed up when their benefits are placed on the chopping block and not knowing whether the bedroom tax is going to be affected them this year, next year or whenever, and fed up that at the same time that the DUP were squandering up to £600 million, the rest of us were told to tighten our belts, and fed up that just months after thousands of people marched through Belfast city centre and other cities against the cuts detailed in the Stormont House Agreement, Sinn Féin and the DUP began implementing exactly those cuts. And the DUP and Sinn Féin executive has been committed to a programme of austerity and cuts, and the RHI scheme, Mr Speaker, is only the latest example of how the executive puts the interests of the wealthy before the interests of the vast majority here. And their proposed corporation tax cut on top of the RHI will only give another handout to big companies and the rich. And the corporation tax cut will lose around £300 million a year from the block grant, and add that on top of the £600 million lost to RHI, on top of £700 million agreed by the executive to make 20,000 public sector workers, public sector jobs, redundant in the Fresh Start Agreement. Add that all up and you get £1.5 billion. £1.5 billion in one way or another that was redirected away from people who need it the most. £1.5 billion that could have been spent on waiting lists, could have been spent on jobs, could have been spent on mental health services to top up benefits to protect vulnerable people. Instead, we see cuts. Cuts and warm Ferraris. And what we need to see now is First Minister, or former First Minister, Arlene Foster, and everyone responsible for the burn to earn scandal to be held to account. We do need a public inquiry to establish exactly who these people are. And on top of this, we need a full list of the beneficiaries of the RHI scheme, and they should be published. All the contracts awarded through RHI, like the Chargehurst Ferrari dealership, to collect money for the next 18 years should be rescinded and ended immediately. And we need to see the money wrongly paid out through RHI paid back into the public purse, back into public services. And anything short, Mr Speaker, of these measures will not deliver the kind of accountability that the public wants and deserves. And we need to see accountability because, as we know now, despite warning after warning about the scheme and cost of it, Arlene Foster refused to listen to those calls. And when Arlene Foster wrote to banks outlining the tariffs for companies would be protected, she urged banks to look favourably on approaches from businesses, quoting directly. And this is what is at the heart of the scandal, making policies, designing policies that are in the interest of corporations in the belief that increasing benefits for corporations, reducing their taxes, will lead to a trickle-down of wealth. Mr Speaker, we have decades of evidence that trickle-down economics does not work and only makes the rich richer. And we found out yesterday the scandalous news that 6 billionaires own more wealth than the world's poorest 50% of the world's population. What a disgusting state of affairs. And what a disgraceful state of affairs we have right here in our own backyard. And we should be asking ourselves today, what kind of society is the executive creating here, where people are dying on the streets while Ferraris are heated almost free of charge? And the RHI scandal may be heralded as the straw that broke the camel's back, but there were deaths on our streets long before this particular scandal, and no one threatened to bring down the house. So what kind of status quo are we being asked to return with the big parties?
The case for a public inquiry under the Inquiries Act is unanswerable. The question is, why have we not already got one? And the answer in large measure is because the parties hitherto of government have, to this point, blocked such an inquiry. Indeed, with considerable vehemence, we were told by Mr. Poots just 4 weeks ago. Get the message, he said. there will not be a public inquiry. Well, there's nothing like a looming election to focus minds and to try and get on the right side of public opinion. And so now we're told that the DUP supports a public inquiry. Good. In fact, we were told this day last week by Mrs. Foster that one was going to be announced within 24 hours. Where is it? Was that just another soundbite to get through another day? The case for a public inquiry is overwhelming. There are some things which are... Yes, okay, for.
I thank the member for giving way. And as I indicated in the speech that I made 4 weeks ago, that the Savile-type inquiry, the Chilcot-type inquiry, is not in anybody's interest. That if you go back to how I dealt with Pseudomonas, for example, we had an inquiry done and dusted within a matter of months with a hyponatremia inquiry, which he rightly asked a question about, which has cost £15 million and 7 years later hasn't delivered the answers, is not the way forward. We want the truth.
Well,
the member has an extra minute.
There is never was a need for a protracted inquiry because there are, not just yet, there are very net issues to be addressed. This isn't a Savile or anything else. This is something that can be done in a few months at most because it's a very focused issue. Indeed, there are some issues that it's abundantly clear that there are answers already to them. There are other issues where answers are definitely needed. But for example, there's no dispute that it was Arlene Foster and Arlene Foster alone who signed off this scheme, who decided as a policy to take out of the GB scheme the tiering in the tariffs with the disastrous consequences. That is indisputable. She and she alone decided that. Yes, there are areas to be explored. Some of them go to the heart of this matter and the heart of potential corruption at this matter. Like, why was the date of the 1st of October 2015 as the end date of the old scheme and the start date of the amended scheme with tariffs? Why was that date changed? Who changed it? At whose behest? At whose direction? For whose benefit? Those are the questions that go to the heart of this matter. And Mr. Bell has shed some light on that by indicating that compulsion was applied. And indeed, he said this morning that within half an hour of him deciding to close the scheme, his instruction was countermanded by Stormont Castle. Now, if that relates to the 1st of October, then that is going to the heart of the matter. And why would there be such a countermanding? Yes, indeed.
Closure of the scheme.
Not the reduction in the tariff.
Glad for the clarification. So there was a vested interest somewhere about the closure of the scheme, it seems. And what Mr. Bell suggests, that vested interest rested in Stormont Castle. Now, isn't that exactly the sort of thing that we need to have ventilated and exposed to the glare of a public inquiry? Maybe that is why, until this moment, there has been great reticence, reluctance from the primary party of government to have a public inquiry. If there are countermanding instructions emanating from Stormont Castle, then that might well be a reason, but it's not a reason to deny the public the truth, and that is what must be obtained.
Before I call Mr. Raymond McCann, I have to remind him that he has only 4 minutes. If he takes an intervention, he will not get an extra minute. Mr. McCann.
Thank you, and Mr. Speaker, I take that as a warning to everybody else. Don't ask me to give way. I won't, sort of, at the light of what the Speaker has said. Mistakes, flaws. We've heard these sort of words over and over again here, sort of, that nobody spotted the flaw in the scheme. The regulator didn't spot it, departmental officials didn't spot it. The implication being that how could you expect a poor, simple politician to have spotted it when all these other people couldn't miss it? Well, there might be an explanation for this, you know. When we think of a flaw, we usually think of something that has deteriorated or something was missed or so on. The reason why nobody spotted the flaw is there was no flaw in this system. No flaw at all. This was deliberate. It was deliberate. It was conscious. This is afterwards to me that we can't be accusing people of criminality and fraud and all the rest of it. I don't accuse any individual of being a criminal or a fraudster. What I do say is this, as a flat fact, that there was criminality here, that there was fraud here, and the task is really to get to the bottom of that and to hold those responsible to account. The scandal which has been, which has emerged in all this doesn't just have to do with the RHI scheme. We're not going to go into all the other things, which are relevant, going back to Red Scare and the rest of it. We're going to hear a bit more about all those things. You know, remember when NAMA comes down the road in a few months, and that the scandalous facts of that come out into the open. We have another crisis. I mean, had we got over this one? Had we got over this one? That crisis would have come along, the NAMA crisis, before the end of this year, and we'd have been here. And if we sort of all go away, sort of, and stand in an election, and we come back, and we are told over and over again by commentators, quite sharp, acerbic commentators, tell us there's no real point in having this election because everybody's going to come back in the same numbers, or at least the DUP and Sinn Féin are going to come back in the same numbers, so nothing will have been solved. The DUP seems to think that. The DUP take their voters for fools. The DUP treat their electorate like fools, use them as voting fodder, operate on the assumption that no matter what they do, they can rally people to the flag come election day. Well, we shall see. We shall see. It is possible that we can reach a tipping point in these things, you know. And any ordinary Protestant person out there who has voted DUP in the past, we invite them, and people before profit, we invite them to look at the representation they have been given, to look sort of at who has been represented, whom has been represented by the DUP. Is it them? When we're talking about the who's responsible for these hundreds of thousands and millions of pounds and so forth, meanwhile, back in the real world, we have people named and shamed in front of their neighbours because allegedly they have conned £1,000 from the public purse because they're doing the double or some things like that. We have government websites out asking people to phone in and tell them, sort of, and tell the police about who's defrauding them. Be a tout on your neighbours in relation to Social Security and the rest of it. Meanwhile, major crime goes on. We've learned a few other things in all this. We're certainly around about Mrs. Foster, sort of, and sort of Sinn Féin and the rest of the DUP. Let us remember when we look back at all this, that when this scandal first emerged, both the DUP and Sinn Féin were against the public inquiry, adamantly against it. Sinn Féin was against it, then put out a statement saying that they were in favour of it, then withdrew that statement and said, oh, that was a typographical error. Do they take us all for fools, Sinn Féin and the DUP? They do, in a sense, because they believe that all they have to do is play to the expectations of their own community, and it doesn't matter what else they do. Thank you very much.
I call Mr. Steve Aiken to wind up the debate on the motion, and the member has 10 minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Speaker. And thank you. I'm sorry, Gerry, for the apologies for that, but let's crack on. Thank you. And before I look to surmise, those of all who have contributed in this debate, and I thank everybody who has been involved in this debate, and particularly for the vigour and the clear direction that you've put into the discussion of this debate and some of the key areas that have come out of this as well. And before I add my clear support to the motion, I would like to make a few pertinent remarks about helping to restore confidence in the institutions and, above all, get to the truth. and many of these speakers will talk to these. Firstly, given Simon Hamilton's push for the SR yesterday and the need to expedite the hemorrhaging of funding from our very, very constrained budgets of 85k a year, he has, as Mr Dixon has quite clearly pointed out, he has the opportunity, even at this late stage, and I would like him at this late stage to call for a public inquiry and set it up and get it moving. He can do the right thing. Do the right thing now. We also talked about the standing aside without prejudice, and one of the things we talked about, the standing aside of prejudice with the First Minister as we were going forward, and how that could have helped restore the confidence, not only to get to the bottom of the RHI scandal, but also, probably more importantly, to restore confidence in this institution and in the Government of Northern Ireland. We have turned what was a financial crisis into an existential threat to the whole of these institutions and what is happening in Northern Ireland. We need to move on from this, and there was an opportunity for leadership and direction, and that has very sadly, for everybody here, been missed. So I'd like to go on to some of the comments as we go through as well. First of all, thank you very much indeed, Clare. Oh, sorry. Thank you very much indeed for Clare for his excellent and eloquent introduction. And about the first time I've heard this about the 12 days of Christmas approach. But I think it is vitally important that the judge is appointed by the Lord Chief Justice. Okay? It cannot be the Attorney General. And I think from all of us from this end of the Assembly would very clearly talk about that as well. When we're talking about Emma Little-Pengelly, thank you very much indeed for your contribution. But we were unsure about what you were saying about a public inquiry. Do you want a public inquiry? Please say it. Yes. Robin Swan, thank you very much indeed for your contribution. And thank you very much indeed. And I know the constraints you have of being the chair of the PAC. But I think everybody at this end of the House would very clearly give thanks to your chairmanship and to the PAC as well for the hard work and what they've done in bringing these issues to the fore. To Stephen Farry, I think I too am particularly surprised that HM Treasury are not interested in what's going on. Because the issue here is not just the question of potential 0.6 of a billion. The issue here is the 1.18 billion to the UK taxpayer. And ladies and gentlemen, we're all UK taxpayers. And this, I'm surprised that this is not of interest going forward. To Gordon Dunn, Gordon, I think I would fully support and agree with your comments you made about what is going on. The lack of business process, risk management, even basic project management. This smacks of something that is as bad as the Ministry of Defence used to do in the past. This is like something 20 years ago. There is a definite failure in our mechanisms of government. And whereas I know we will all call for the political side of it as well, but something desperately has to be done about the state and the functioning of our civil service, because quite clearly, at least in the Department of Economy and Delhi, it is not fit for purpose going forward. But thank you. Gordon, thank you very much, and Gordon Lyons, thank you very much indeed for your contribution. But I also was interested in the sort of intervention by my honourable friend, Mr Beggs. And when we were talking about the returns we were looking at, whereas in Northern Ireland you were getting returns in the RHI initiative somewhere in the region of 84%, in GB you were getting a return of about 7.4%. And there's obviously something to be looked at as well, indeed. Christopher Stalford, thank you very much indeed. We missed you. We do enjoy your contributions, and it was good to hear from you again, but thank you. And we will miss you going forward. We do. We enjoy your contributions. But on more serious issues. Sinead, you're quite right. Sinead Bradley pointed out the fact there's a complete lack of clarity of thinking and there is fraudulent activity, or there's suspected fraudulent activity. But there is something in this that needs to be investigated, and I will return to that later on. Paul Frew made a contribution. Thank you very much indeed. And then we moved on to Mr. Bell. Certainly.
Would the member agree with me that the fishing analogy used by Mr. Frew and his contribution
was somewhat unwise when he referred to the feeding frenzy and members of my party being caught on the hook. Well, would you agree, Mr. Speaker, or member, that the only frenzy that I'm aware of, and I'm sure you are only aware of, is the frenzy of people who try to sign up to this botched scheme in the spike, where hundreds and hundreds of people did a veil of it?
Thank you very much, Steve. And yes, I would agree with that going forward. I will.
That's a very important point, and it's reckless for the message to go out here today that there was some sort of frenzy by people trying to get on this scheme for any other reason than they want to be part of the incentive scheme. These are reputable businesses that decided to go forward in a scheme that maybe they were advised to do so by suppliers, by maybe other businesses, and by accountants and everything else. So it's very, very dangerous and reckless to say here today that those people tied up in that spike were doing anything other than carrying on their business.
And I thank Mr. Frew, and thank you very much for leading in, because I was about to talk about the contribution from Mr. Bell, and particularly the concerns about the roles of SPADs, and the fact that there is definitely, and if ever we needed an indication of why we need a public inquiry, what was going on? Who was running the government at the time? Was it the SPADs? Was it the ministers? Was it being properly and accountably looked at? These are really serious questions that need to be asked. Yes, please.
Just briefly on that point, would the member recognise that there is no such concept as a rogue SPAD? Even if a SPAD is acting unilaterally, by definition, they owe their appointment solely to the minister, and the minister is fully accountable for everything the SPAD does.
And, Mayor, thank you for that intervention. And yes, that is the normal course, custom and practice of the role of special advisers. But for some strange reason here in Northern Ireland, in our Sinn Féin DUP SPADocracy, we have seemed to have completely missed that point going forward. No, I'll just continue on for a moment. To a contribution from Philip Smith, that was very clear and very concise and brought out some of the most important and key issues going forward as well. But I was interested in Mr. Poots's comments about culpability, and I think you're quite right that we do need to look at all the chain. And one of the things we would look at considerably in the military would be the chain of command. All the way from the top, all the way to the bottom. Yeah. All needs to be looked at. To Nicola. Nicola, thank you very much indeed for your contribution again, and indeed, unquestionable truths. Because what we need to do, and need to be very clear about, is dealing with these unquestionable truths, and that can only be led by a public inquiry. And Stephen, thank you very much indeed for pointing out, and thank you very much indeed for supporting our plan indeed for moving towards making sure that we have a windfall tax. And we should also explore the issues as well of looking at how we might look at the rating scheme to reduce that as well. We haven't had the chance to look at sufficient detail of any of these issues, and we've looked to do that as well. Gerry, thank you very much indeed, and Eamon as well, but there is definitely a very clear issue of accountability here and where accountability lasts. Everybody in Northern Ireland is asking the answers to this, and these are key questions going forward. And I think these are things that we talk about as well. Again, I think, from Jim Allister's contribution, I think eloquence in itself, but very, very clear on the reasons why we definitely need a public inquiry. And the question again being asked, while the Minister is still here, why does he not call for a public inquiry now? So, In my final comments, Mr. Speaker, I talked to a serious matter that the Economy Minister raised yesterday and has been alluded to during these discussions. And that has been the question of potential fraud. It will be of no surprise that these matters involving many millions would, in normal circumstances and indefinitely in Great Britain, would require the attention of the Serious Fraud Office. Today, as a party, we have written to the PSNI to ask what actions they are taking to investigate this scandal. Now that the Minister has clearly stated his suspicions, Mr. Speaker, very clearly of fraud. I move we support this motion. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.